Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and my dear friends. No distance of place or lapse of time can lessen the friendship of those who are thoroughly persuaded of each other's worth. This is a famous quote of Robert Southey, an English poet of the Romantic period. Today we are separated because of unquestionable circumstances, yet united through our quest for knowledge. We have gathered here today on this online platform for the PSI lecture series, and it gives me immense pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Jyoti Srivastav, an eminent scientist of the Birbal Sahani Institute of Paleosciences, Lucknow. Dr. Jyoti was awarded the gold medal in MSc Botany from the Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi, in 2006. In the year 2013, she completed her PhD in botany from the Lucknow University with specialization in quaternary paleontology and coastal ecosystems. In the same year, she joined Birbal Sahani Institute of Paleosciences, Lucknow. Dr. Jyoti has a keen interest for earth system dynamics and climate change over a range of timescales, with a concern for human-environment interaction, past, present, and future. She holds expertise in mangrove paleontology, quaternary stratigraphy, paleoecology and paleoclimatology, estuary modeling, and the philosophy of environmental change. She also has expertise in analyzing the quantitative relationship between source taxon vegetation frequency and its pollen representation at a community scale. Dr. Jyoti has 20 published research papers to her credit. She is currently guiding 2 PhD students and has trained 6 students of MSc and BTech in the field of paleontology. Ma'am, we are highly honored to have you amongst us and look forward to your guidance. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction, and a very good morning to all the eminent researchers and all my colleagues here. And today I would be talking about the fossil pollen records, which are well-established indicators of past vegetation changes, and the prevalence of fossil pollen across environmental settings, including lakes, wetlands, and marine sediments, has made paleontology as one of the most ubiquitous and valuable tools for studying past environmental changes and climate change globally for decades. So I would be sharing my screen for the presentation. Is my presentation visible? Is the screen up?
Yes.
So I would be start talking about a recent approach which we are developing in the present time based on pollen studies. And we are trying to reconstruct the past vegetation and climate on the quantitative perspective. Hence, it is well understood that intensive work has been done on the local and the global scales on pollen studies, which has led to a body of literature regarding its strengths and weaknesses as a climate indicator. So fossil pollen records have been recovered from almost all regions of the world that we know, including the ocean sediments and the ice cores. So spanning from quaternary time to in the deep time as well, we have decades of paleoecological and paleoclimate research which has produced a wealth of fossil pollen records from thousands of locations, which are and new records are regularly being published. So with its global prevalence and diverse range of sensitivities, fossil pollen represents a powerful paleoclimate proxy and a basis for quantitative climate reconstructions and it can be improved. And the understanding can be also improved on the basis of its global climate dynamics. So here we are talking about the pollen-based climate reconstructions which are performed at the site level to provide a precise understanding of how the local climate changed over time, as these reconstructions are expressed in the same units. Like we say regional to continental synthesis, we can extract the climate change patterns which has happened in the past and inform about the past atmospheric change. Let's come to this slide over here. The picture which you see over here, it is the place where I got first acquainted to this approach of the quantitative reconstruction. And this is the workstation where we have been working. And from this time, I got influenced by this approach and we started applying it in our daily studies. So here I would talk about, firstly, I will talk about the basics of pollen analysis that most of us know, but a quick revision for everyone, as I will talk about the basics and the principle behind pollen analysis. After that, the most important aspect of pollen-vegetation relationship and why it is required in the determination of past vegetation dynamics through fossil pollen. Then we will focus on the complementary approach based on statistical techniques to derive the quantitative estimates of vegetation and climate conditions from pollen assemblages, and what is the standard protocol for field sampling. That is the major step in towards this quantification technique. And at last, some case studies from India based on the approach and in order to have a more accurate picture of the past plant diversity and the way this has shaped and changed through time, which would lead to a better understanding of vegetation and climate in the past. So coming to ecology, as everyone knows, I'm a paleoecologist and I study the past environmental changes and I reconstruct them over the periods of thousands of years, mainly focusing on the Holocene, that is the last 11,000 years. And so firstly, what is ecology? Ecology means the study of complex relationships between the living organism and its present environment. So the paleoecology, as it literally means old ecology, is the ecology of the past. And it is linked to both biology and geology, and it can be any period of Earth's history. And it is studied basically from fossil plants and animal remains preserved in sediments. It involves the reconstruction of biota that lived in the past, the reconstruction of communities that lived in the past, and the reconstruction of landscapes and ecosystems. It also involves the reconstruction of past environments that include climate and possible human impacts. Coming to palynology, which is the basic tool which we take up for studying this past studies. And it is the study of plant pollen spores and certain microscopic planktonic organisms in both living and fossil forms. For a botanist, well, a botanist uses a living pollen and spore to study the plant relationships, its physiology, and its evolution, while a geologist or a palynologist uses fossil pollen and spores for studying environments, stratigraphy, historical geology, and paleontology. Apart from that, palynology has also its applications in archaeology, forensic science, and crime scene investigations, and some allergy studies. And the basic behind the palynology is that the palynomorphs, which are taken in palynology, are approximately of the size between 5 to 500 microns. And this is the basic structure of a pollen. This is for all who have been thinking of taking palynology as the approach of their research work. So a pollen grain consists of a hard outer wall, that is called an exine, and an inner soft wall, that is the intine, which encloses all the organelles and the nuclei within it. And if you see in this picture, this is a pollen of Malvaceae family, and this has a specific exine pattern. This is a unique thing that every single plant species has a specific ornamentation, specific structure, and we identify the pollen on the basis of their structure. And when these pollen are dispersed into the environment, they fall on the female gametophyte of the flower and they germinate to take up the fertilization process. So, coming to palynology and its applications, we all know it can be used in phylogenetic studies. It can be utilized for plant identification, for extant plants as well as the fossil plants. And talking about plant communities in the past, the climate, biogeography, and also the migration of these taxa in the deep time. And if we are taking up palynology, the most prime thing which has to be taken is the pollen morphology, which is the basic criteria for their identification, and it is often used to identify a particular taxon. So coming to pollen morphology, we have a range of characters which we identify, and then the next feature of a plant, which is very important, is the pollen production. As it is stated here, pollen production is inversely proportional to the probability of fertilization. All plants have a specific pattern of fertilization. It could be self-fertilizing plants like autogamous, insect-fertilizing plants, which are called entomophilous, and wind-dispersed plants that are anemophilous. So it is always seen that the wind-dispersed plants, like the anemophilous plants, produce the greatest amount of pollen, and most of the angiosperms and all the gymnosperms come under anemophilous plants. Then comes the entomophilous plants. As their pollen are bigger in size, they have discrete exine structure, they are lesser in number, and the least amount of pollen is produced by autogamous plants. So the pollen production depends on the grain shape and the weight, wind velocity, wind direction, and the canopy cover. So while studying pollen, we have to take care of these physiological aspects of each and every plant before characterizing the past environment and the vegetation composition. As stated before, the pollen production is species specific. Some plants produce around 70,000 grains per anther, and some plants only produce 100 grains per anther. And this pollen record which we get are mainly biased towards wind-pollinated plants, which are mainly most of the gymnosperms. And because they produce vast quantities of pollen, they are always overrepresented in the pollen diagram. So the basic features, the pollen features which are used in paleoecological studies are the pollen aperture. As we know, there are two types of apertures. We have a pore, or there could be a longitudinal opening, which is called a colpi. Then we have a pollen size. Pollen size also varies from 5 microns to 100 or 200 microns, and that size is also species specific. Then comes the pollen shape. It could be circular in shape, it could be oblong. All these characters has to be thoroughly studied before taking up it. Along with that, pollen structure, as I stated earlier, the exine pattern is very essential to be studied before taking up pollen analysis. This is a typical pollen dispersal curve. If you see over here, a pollen dispersal curve estimate is a critical process which shapes the vegetation diversity in natural plant population. Hence, estimating the pollen dispersal curve can provide insights of its evolutionary dynamics in plant populations, and it is an essential background for making predictions about vegetation changes induced by climatic shifts. This is a typical pollen dispersal curve showing that the pollen from local plants get dispersed to the greatest amount in the site. And apart from that, the extra local pollen, which is transported from the hinterland, they get deposited after that, and the regional pollen is dispersed in the least amount, which is mainly transported by air currents. So we always see that when we get a pinus pollen, they are not more in number when we see the records from the peninsular India. But when we look for mangroves, we find larger quantity of mangroves because they are locally deposited in the estuaries. So there are several factors which are taken into consideration when we look up to the pollen representation of vegetation in the sediment sample. And these are the main factors which we have to take care of. First being the spatial pattern of the source plants. Like if we see over here, this is a basin, and the source plants over here, you see it's a densely forested region. But on the other side, we see a vegetation that is sparsely located, and there are open patches and some trees in between. So this particular pattern of vegetation, or the spatial pattern of vegetation, has to be considered. And for that, we do the vegetation survey of the area wherever we take the modern surface sampling. Then comes the basin size. Whether it's a deep basin or it's a shallow one, that also makes a difference in the pollen representation of vegetation. Apart from that, pollen dispersal characteristics, like the fall speed of the pollen, that is also an important aspect which have to look while quantifying the vegetation of the past. And the fourth one being the of utmost importance is the pollen productivity, that I have talked before, that how much pollen a plant produces, that varies from plant to plant, and that has to be estimated to get a clear picture or a precise picture of the vegetation of the past. So here I have given an example of the transport pathways of pollen entering an estuary. If we see over here, there are several routes from where the pollen is transported into an estuary. First being the atmospheric pollen or the airborne component, which is long distance pollen. And along with that, we have another air dispersed pollen component, that is the canopy or the trunk space pollen, which comes from the short and the medium distance from within the forest system. And then comes the gravity component. The gravity component enters the system through the fluvial system. It could be from the open land areas or the canopy areas. Apart from that, we also have some reworked system, and all these transport pathways bring in the pollen loading, which get deposited into the estuary, and it is the sign of what kind of vegetation was present in the regional scale. So all these components have to be studied before taking up any site for pollen analysis. And the basic principle behind pollen analysis, if you see in this figure, by Tauber, this is a Tauber model of pollen taphonomy into a surface sample. So we see over here that the wind speed depends, the transport of the component of the pollen majorly depends on the wind speed. And the wind speed from the canopy component is always between 2 to 6 meters per second. It is usually 3 meters, while in the trunk space, the wind speed is reduced. So we generally show that the local deposition of pollen due to reduction, there is local deposition of pollen due to the reduction of the wind speed which carries it. So wind speed is the major factor which we have to take care. So finally, we conclude from the pollen dispersal composition that travel distance is inversely proportional to the pollen grain size. Pollen grains are filtered when they move through the canopy. When they move in the open air space, they are freely transported. But when they move through the canopy, the wind speed reduces and it gets deposited on the local site only. Some light pollen grains can be transported to local distances, long distances in the upper atmosphere. And in general, the pollen from low standing plants have low probability of dispersal. So then coming to the pollen vegetation relationship, how we translate the pollen assemblages into quantitative estimates of vegetation. Well, this is not a straightforward exercise, and it requires a lot of data collection. And this pollen vegetation relationship is governed by various processes, which we have talked till now. And based on those processes, three broad classes of approaches to reconstruct the past vegetation from pollen records have been identified. And there have been researchers working on that. First being the comparison with samples taken from analogous environments. This we generally do. We have such analogous environments. We go for sampling on those environments which give us a quantitative vegetation image of the past. Apart from that, biomization is another technique which has been frequently used, where the pollen types are related to their plant functional types. Their climatic preferences are studied, and the proportion of these functional types give us or help in identifying the most likely biome in which these plants must have survived in the past. And the third approach is the application of process-based models. Here, I'll be talking about the process-based models. And these process-based models are the approaches that take the algebraic model of the relationship between pollen assemblages and the plant producing it. And this model will help, and it is used, it mainly uses that to translate the pollen data into quantitative measures of vegetation cover. The paper here, which I have put, is the one of the pioneer works by Bunting et al. And this gives us the basic methodology, which is required, a standard protocol, which has to be followed to initiate this approach. And we have been initiating and we have been working on this approach since the last 2 and 3 years. And we are developing this protocol in our institute. And coming to this model, which is called the Prentice-Sujita model, it's a linear process-based model. And it includes a taxon-specific measure of pollen production. As I revealed earlier, pollen production is a most important parameter which we have to look while studying the pollen for past vegetation analysis and the present time. Pollen productivity is a simple measure of the amount of pollen that a plant releases per unit area of the pollen producing plant. So we have to see at what distance, in what pattern that plant is growing in the environment, and what amount of pollen it produces. These two parameters has to be considered deeply. So pollen productivity expressed in grains per meter square, but when we relate it to a reference taxon, it becomes the relative pollen productivity, which is a dimensionless ratio. And what is a reference taxon? First of all, we have to choose a reference taxon based on our survey. And this reference taxon is the family or any taxon that is present in both pollen and vegetation data from many of the sites sampled as possible. And in most of the cases, as we see Poaceae pollen, it's the grass family pollen, it is diverse and it is present, it is overrepresented in our pollen record. Even in the vegetation data, we get it in most of the forms, it is abundant. So we take Poaceae as the reference taxon in most of the cases. And the current reconstruction models assume that the pollen productivity of a given taxon is constant through space and time. As it's a physiological character, it doesn't change through time. So while taking these two parameters, another thing which we need to consider is a vegetation survey, which should be based on the pollen's eye view, how the pollen sees the environment and the pollen gets deposited, not in the perception the way we see the vegetation. Like the vegetation ecologist's view is not taken over here. How the pollen responds to the environmental parameters, how it gets settled into the basin, these characters are taken into consideration, and a standard vegetation survey protocol has been methodized, and which is called a Strackel's bequest protocol, which has been established in Europe, and they have been able to quantify this vegetation reconstruction for the past Holocene time span, and understanding what aspects of vegetation are seen and recorded by the pollen assemblage is very important component in the interpretation of reconstruction of vegetation mosaics. Another important term which we need to look over is the relevant source area of the pollen. This term is quite simple to define, as it is the radial axis or the radial space of the pollen and the vegetation till where the vegetation and pollen relationship is built. That is the distance at which the goodness of the fit of the pollen vegetation relationship of the model doesn't improve. Like after that, there is no influence of the vegetation on the pollen dispersal. So this is the relevant source area of the pollen, which we also consider in this approach. And this is the fundamental equation of pollen representation of vegetation based on this model, which says that the pollen loading or the pollen deposited in a sedimentary environment is linear to the distance weighted plant abundance of that particular plant. Like distance weighted plant abundance is the vegetation survey I've been talking about. That is very crucial because that only gives us the dimensions in which the pollen has been dispersed in the environment. Some assumptions have been made in this model, like the dominant agent of pollen transport is taken as wind above the canopy. Then there are no preservation biases of the pollen which exists, and pollen productivity is taken constant in space and time. Wind is blown uniformly in all direction, and the sedimentary basin has been assumed to be circular. These are the prime assumptions made in this model. So now we see how we select the study area or the site selection for estimating the plant productivity. This is a study from the southern Sweden, and they have taken sites on the random basis. It should not be in a transect or in a grid pattern. The sites should be randomly distributed, and this is a very important step for developing the pollen productivity estimates. And the site should be of the size of 100 kilometer area, and it should be homogeneous patches of species population or vegetation types. And the distance between the two sites should not be very, it should not be of the size of the radius of one site, so that to avoid autocorrelation. And there could be some overlapping, that is accepted, but the model should not take it as one side and autocorrelated. So these parameters we have to see while choosing the sites. And then the taxon which we take up, like what taxons we can identify the pollen productivity estimate of. These taxons are mainly half of the number of sites we take. If we take 14 sites and we see the vegetation pattern of these sites, we can estimate the pollen productivity of 7 taxon. And this is how we have to choose more number of sites to estimate more number of taxons. So only the taxa which is important in the interpretation of the fossil pollen diagram, we take those taxas which are ecologically important in the past vegetation as well as in the present time. So the taxa that represent spread values both in vegetation and pollen data, we also can take up those taxa as the primary ones. And those which are rare in the vegetation, uncommon ones, they cannot be fit into the model. This is a drawback for this model. Now coming to the pollen sampling. We need to collect pollen surface samples also to develop this quantification approach. And pollen surface sample could be a moss cushion. It could be we can put the traps, pollen traps on the site where we study, or we can collect the surface sediment samples, which could give us years of data from lakes and bogs. Now we see the field work for sampling of pollen and vegetation survey. As I shown earlier, like we have to see the vegetation pattern in concentric rings. This is a normal vegetation survey in which we see there are three steps to it. In first step, we collect the pollen sample from the center of that site. And from that site, we move radially towards outward. We move radially from 0 to 10 meters. And in this particular radius, we take the detailed vegetation survey with the help of quadrants which are placed at regular intervals. I would be showing you the pattern in which the quadrants are placed. From 0 to 10 meters, we take detailed vegetation survey. Then from 10 to 100 meters, we make vegetation maps or the community maps. Based on our visualization, how the patterns are arranged, vegetation pattern is arranged, where there is any housing plans or there are any animal cultures, and all these things are taken into consideration while making these community maps. So this is how the community map looks when it is drawn in the field. Then this is the pattern in which the vegetation survey is conducted. As I told, in 0 to 10 meters, we place the quadrant at regular intervals and we take the vegetation data in the form of percentage of vegetation. Then from 10 to 100, with the help of ropes or with the help of quadrants, from these four directions, we can say the vegetation, we can estimate the vegetation communities by looking at the, we can say the forest communities or the open vegetation patches. We can estimate from these. And from 100 to 1000 meters, This gap is taken by with the help of GIS images, Google Earth pictures, or aerial photographies, because here we just see the vegetation community that has been surviving in the area. Then when we have to study further from 1000 meters to 5000 meters, that is 5 kilometers, we use digitized maps for that survey. So this is a strenuous exercise, and we have to work beforehand. Time work, but we have to work on this thoroughly. Like we see over here, from 0 to 10 meters, we have these quadrants, and we calculate the percentage of vegetation in these squares, and this is how it is done in the field. Then coming to 10 to 100 meters, the vegetation communities are mapped. Like herb communities are seen in square meters. Forest communities can be seen from the canopy or the branches or the leaves. There is a proper protocol for calculating them. And then comes from 100 to 1500 or 2000 meters. These vegetation types are identified on the basis of aerial photographs or GIS images. So this is the final picture from a study from Ukraine, which have taken so many sites. The researchers have taken so many sites, and they are overlapping at some points. And you see over here, they have applied this vegetation survey protocol. And on the basis of this, they could demarcate these particular vegetation types in the area. And after, obviously, for this large survey, we require a good team. So it is better to have a large field crew or a joint field work for that. At our institute also, when we go for a field for this approach, we take all the groups, we come together, all the palynologists, and we go for the field for the survey. It is good to educate the new scholars in the field work for this technique and data handling. And it is always more fun to have a good team and a big team for the vegetation survey. So how the data is input into the models? We see over here, now we have the vegetation data which needs to be converted into ERV and into a particular program with the help of vegetation survey program, which can be read by the ERV model. ERV model is the model which I'm talking of for quantifying this vegetation survey data. Apart from that, we require the map data also. Those maps which we constructed or we have drawn in the field, that have to be digitized in GIS. And these grid maps are uploaded in the vegetation survey software to make it readable for the ERV model. Another term which is required to be known is the fall speed of the pollen. The speed at which the pollen falls for getting deposited in the sediment. That's it. That is the settling velocity, which is dependent on the size and the shape of the pollen. And it is unique for all pollen types. And we see over here, we calculate this fall speed of the pollen on the basis of a software in which we put in the mean diameter reading of 30 pollen grain specimens. We do the morphometry of each taxon's 30 pollen grain specimens, and we take the mean of that diameter reading and we put it into the software to get the fall speed of that pollen based on Stokes' law. This fall speed of the pollen is also required for this quantification analysis. So at the end, the output of that model, we get the fall speed of the pollen and we get the pollen productivity estimates of the taxon which we selected and which are important for our reconstruction approach. So this is a study from the southern Sweden, and they have tried to estimate these pollen productivity of these major taxa in their field. And now comes the past quantitative reconstruction for past climate and vegetation. And here the landscape reconstruction algorithm that is used is basically of two types. The first one being the local, when the site is small and we need to look for the local vegetation estimates, we use the LOVE model, and it also requires the same parameters which have been talking about, is the pollen productivity estimate, the regional vegetation composition, and it is mainly taken up for the basin, which are around 10. When we look at the regional vegetation composition, we take the REVEALS model, which is a regional estimates of vegetation abundance from large sites. And this also takes the pollen productivity estimates and the regional vegetation picture. So whichever model which we need to apply, we go for that model. And this is how the output of the model looks like. This is the pollen diagram, which we have always been seeing, but this is a quantitative reconstruction based on LRA reconstruction, which is showing the vegetation cover for the last 3,000 years. And this is another study from the REVEALS model. As we see over here, it is giving a regional picture of the vegetation composition in different zones or different areas of Scotland. Now, for a palynologist, it is easy to interpret like this how the vegetation composition is changing. But when we look at the from the view of another person who is a non-palynologist, how he or she interprets this with pollen diagram, it is quite hard. Yes? Okay, shall I continue?
Yeah.
Unmute yourself, Jyoti. Unmute yourself. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I did it.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So if we see a pollen diagram, see this is loaded with information, but it is very hard for any non-palynologist to interpret. But after this quantitative reconstruction, we can form these kind of spatial diagrams in which we can show the local vegetation reconstruction around a sampling site. And this can be further translated into spatial distribution of the vegetation pattern. So this is easier for anyone to interpret how the spatial distribution of vegetation has taken place from the past till the present. So this approach will definitely help in giving a precise knowledge about the vegetation reconstruction. So the applications and the implications of this model, as we say, it can reconstruct key stages of landscape and vegetation development with higher significance and thus circumvent the biases or nullify the biases created by the direct interpretation of the palynological records. It can study the pollen productivity for important regional plant taxa, which enhances its estimations. And then it can be applied to key stages of Holocene to address the questions concerning fluctuations in the forest and the open land ratio due to human-induced disturbances and ecosystem diversity changes. So its results can improve our understanding of the climate-vegetation interactions and human responses in the past, as well as our ability to interpret the functioning of the future ecosystem. Further testing of REVEALS and LOVE is necessary. As we are seeing over here, we require a lot of studies to be conducted in the tropical regions, also in the bog environments, in the peat sediments, so that we can more test these models. And this LRA needs reliable estimates of pollen productivity estimates from various regions for better reconstructions. So this has to be shared more and more so that we can build up this approach in a great detail. Coming to the case studies from the Indian subcontinent, as we have taken that initiative around 7 years back, and the first one to deal with is from the French Institute Pondicherry. They have worked on this since the past 5 to 7 years, and they are developing the relative pollen productivity estimates of the key pollen taxa in the southeast of India. And they are also testing the REVEALS model in the southeast of India, which is a great initiative by the paleoecology group of the French Institute Pondicherry. And this is another study from the southwest of India, which is conducted by my team. And we are also doing vegetation survey for modern pollen quantification. And we have selected 6 key taxa based on their occurrences both in modern and fossil pollen samples, as we have also studied the core samples from these locations. and along with their abundances in the present day vegetation. These key taxa are Dipterocarpaceae, Miliaceae, Syzygium, Terminalia, Artemisia, and Acacia pollen. And we have done the vegetation survey based on that to Crackle's protocol. And we are looking forward for selecting more sites in the area. This is another modern pollen quantification approach which has been taken in the Central Ganga Plains by our institute. And all the palynologists from the quaternary group have actively participated in collecting the vegetation data. And this is also like under progress, and we are trying to develop this protocol in the tropical regions of in India. And this is how the approach goes, and this is the vegetation survey software in which we feed in the data of the vegetation survey. This is the community map which we digitize and upload it. And these are the pollen taxa which we identify in the modern pollen sample. And on the basis of that, we make a master directory of the key taxon which we have to consider while making the quantitative reconstruction. So our aim is to generate pollen productivity estimates for tropical flora of India in order to provide a quantitative reconstruction of past landscape for better visualization of the past vegetation and climate. Furthermore, the use of modern analog approach combined with the application of models of dispersal and deposition is probably the soundest direction to take for applying mod pollen analysis to the reconstruction of past vegetation and landscape in quantitative terms and in terms of local and regional scale. I know this quantitative calibration is a complex matter, but it is worth taking a trouble to achieve this goal because it is theoretically possible and it provides a unique opportunity to develop a field, the field of vegetation history. And I hope this talk would provide anyone going for pollen analysis an interpretation that will enable reconstruction of past landscapes from pollen records as precisely as possible in terms of composition, abundance, and the spatial distribution of plant species. So thank you to the organizers and thank you to all the eminent scientists here and researchers and my colleagues for taking their time in listening to this talk. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.